Learn from top professors on the road or in your home with Learn 25. Michael Bess is the Chancellor's Professor of History at Vanderbilt University, where he has taught for 3 decades. He received his PhD from the University of California, Berkeley, and he has written 5 books, including Choices Under Fire, Moral Dimensions of World War II. Bess has been awarded the Jeffrey Nordhaus Award for Excellence in Undergraduate Teaching, the Ellen Gregg Ingalls Award for Excellence in Classroom Teaching, and the Vanderbilt Chair of Teaching Excellence.
Lecture 1, Introduction, The Good War and the Challenge of Moral Complexity. In 1995, one of the most venerable museums in the United States, the Smithsonian, attempted to put on an exhibit of the Enola Gay, the B-29 bomber that dropped the atomic bomb on Hiroshima. It seemed, at the time, like a reasonable undertaking. 50 years had passed since the nuclear blast over the Japanese city. The Cold War had ended, prompting widespread reflection about the future role of nuclear weapons in world politics. But the exhibit became a disaster. Long before the scheduled opening date, a powerful alliance of veterans groups and conservative journalists and politicians assailed the script for the proposed exhibit, claiming it was intolerably biased and would bring dishonor on the brave men who had sacrificed so much in the Pacific War. The proposed exhibit, they argued, was blatantly anti-American. It made the dropping of the atomic bomb seem like a gratuitous act of aggression, rather than a decisive military act that brought the ordeal of war to a swift end and thereby saved countless Allied lives. The Smithsonian's team of historians and curators seemed taken aback at first by the uproar. They revised the script several times, seeking to find a compromise that would satisfy the critics. But this, in turn, prompted a backlash from a variety of other groups who claimed that the heavily revised script was now sanitizing the past to fit an uncritically celebratory version of the American role in World War II. The shiny aluminum frame of the B-29 bomber sitting in its hall at the museum had become a symbolically charged focal point for a much wider struggle, the struggle to define America's historical identity and self-image. In the end, the Smithsonian's director decided he had no choice but to abort the proposed exhibit. Some members of Congress had begun darkly hinting that the museum's funding might be cut drastically if the project went ahead as planned. In August 1995, the Enola Gay was unveiled, newly restored, in its Smithsonian Hall. But the rest of the surrounding exhibit had been axed. Anything that might serve to elaborate on the broader significance of the aircraft had been removed. The only information deemed permissible was a technical history of the plane's development, coupled with a terse statement that it had flown the mission that dropped the atomic bomb. No details, no context, no artifacts, no nothing. Just the barest bones of bland information. Was dropping the atomic bomb a just and reasonable way to end the war? Or was it an atrocity that blackens the history of the United States with an indelible stain? And more broadly, what is the most constructive way for such hotly controversial issues to be confronted within the nation's civic culture? All these ongoing debates offer a testimonial to the enduring prominence of World War II in the nation's self-image, and to the deep cleavages that still divide Americans as they look back on the war years. Now, there's an intriguing paradox here, because World War II is widely considered one of the most morally unambiguous military conflicts in history. In the 1980s, when the journalist Studs Terkel conducted interviews with a wide variety of Americans for his oral history of the war, he was astonished to discover that most of the people who'd lived through it, including frontline soldiers, were looking back at the war years with deep nostalgia. One of them even called it the Good War. One man said to Terkel, "It was not like your other wars. It was not fratricidal. It was not, most of us believed, imperialistic. Our enemy was patently obscene, the Holocaust maker. It was one war that many who would have resisted other wars could support enthusiastically. It was a just war, if there is any such animal." Another man told Terkel, "We had 20, 25 years of greatness in our country when we reached out to the rest of the world with help. Some of it was foolish, some of it was misspent, some was in error, many follies. But we had a great reaching out. It was an act of such faith. World War II, it's a war I still would go to." One of the core experiences of this war, strikingly revealed in Terkel's interviews, was about feeling the thrill of moral clarity, a just cause in which you could truly give your all. Both the Allied soldiers who fought overseas and their relatives and fellow citizens who toiled on the home front referred again and again to the exhilaration that they experienced during those years. What lay at stake in this military contest amounted to nothing less than a drastic realignment of world power, with enslavement and genocide looming on the horizon. People knew they were fighting for the defense of their families, their country's independence, their entire way of life. They threw themselves wholeheartedly into an all-out campaign against a vicious aggressor whose culpability in starting the war was utterly beyond doubt. Once the moral stakes had become so sharply defined, even the ultimate risk of sacrificing one's life, if necessary, could make sense and prove profoundly meaningful. Perhaps equally important, both soldiers and civilians could feel a deep sense of comradeship with their fellow citizens who were giving their all to the same overriding cause. Those of us who only know World War II through the history books cannot help but reflect it must have been quite a sensation. The TV newsman, Tom Brokaw, in his book The Greatest Generation, gives an eloquent account of his own reaction as he learned more deeply about the nature of World War II. In 1984, Brokaw was sent by his network, NBC, to do a story on the commemoration ceremonies of the 40th anniversary of D-Day in Normandy. Here's what Brokaw writes. "When I arrived in Normandy, I was simply looking forward to what I thought would be an interesting assignment in a part of France celebrated for its hospitality, its seafood, and its calvados, the local brandy made from apples. Instead, I underwent a life-changing experience. As I walked the beaches with the American veterans who had landed there and now returned for this anniversary, men in their 60s and 70s, and listened to their stories in the cafes and inns, I was deeply moved and profoundly grateful for all they had done. I realized that they had been all around me as I was growing up, and that I had failed to appreciate what they had been through and what they had accomplished." Brokaw's response is an entirely understandable one. His narrative focuses primarily on the American experience of the war, rather than on the equally impressive British, Russian, and other Allied contributions to the defeat of the Axis. But to anyone who reflects for a moment on the consequences that would have followed if the Allies had not prevailed, his account cannot help but ring true. It's hard not to feel a sense of admiration bordering on amazement at the successes achieved against truly daunting odds by the Allied soldiers. Most of them in their late teens and early 20s when they packed off to join the fight. Only the most callous ingrate could fail to acknowledge the immense debt owed to that generation by the generations that have followed. Remembering and celebrating the sacrifices they made in defending our freedom is surely a civic duty we should take great pleasure in fulfilling. So it's fallen to another category of works to explore the darker sides of the war's stories. Those episodes in which moral certainties break down and painful questions compel our attention. This body of literature about World War II is equally as vast and equally as important as the literature that celebrates the war's many moral triumphs. Historians have gradually uncovered over the years a great many of the war's gray areas, those stubbornly controversial aspects of the conflict in which a straightforward moral judgment proves difficult or downright impossible to reach. Such elusive and troubling aspects of the World War II experience can be found among virtually all the principal belligerents. Many Germans, for example, still wrangle among themselves over the question of complicity in the crimes of Nazism. How widely into German society must the net of moral accountability be cast? Japanese and Chinese citizens continue to exchange acrimonious accusations over the nature and implications of the 1937 rape of Nanking. Russians today are only beginning to come to grips with the extent to which their triumph in the great patriotic war was tainted by the grossly inhumane policies of the Stalinist regime, policies of unblinking, feral violence directed both toward enemy populations and toward the Russian soldiers and civilians themselves. Italians erupt periodically into raucous disputes over the legacy of fascism, particularly on such occasions as the elections of 1992, when a granddaughter of Benito Mussolini won election to parliament on an unabashedly neo-fascist ticket. In Britain, on every major anniversary of the great incendiary raids against Hamburg and Dresden, citizens break into bitter arguments over whether the strategic bombing campaign against German civilian centers has irreparably tarnished the nation's finest hour. In 1992, the French president, François Mitterrand, publicly refused to apologize on behalf of the French state for the deportations of Jews carried out 50 years earlier by the Vichy French regime. The resultant national debate raged with an intensity that reminded some observers of the Dreyfus affair. The United States, for its part, has experienced plenty of such controversies surrounding some of its actions during the World War II era. The relatively weak measures taken during the late 1930s to offer assistance or asylum to Europe's Jews. The forcible internment of Japanese American citizens. Widespread racist policies within the U.S. military. The large-scale killing of civilians in the strategic bombing campaign against Germany and Japan. The decision to drop the atomic bomb. Or the flawed conduct of justice in the post-war trials at Nuremberg and Tokyo. Both these contradictory dimensions, the crusade and the ambiguity, the elements of triumph and the elements of doubt and shame, have recurred like leitmotifs in the popular and scholarly literature on World War II that has emerged over the past 80 years. And this should not surprise us, for both these aspects of the war are equally real, and both have an equally valid claim on our attention. As historical observers surveying the moral dimensions of wartime, we find ourselves compelled to wear two very different hats, alternating somewhat awkwardly between them as we move from story to story. One hat represents what might be called the stance of celebration, the imperative one feels to recapture vividly the drama, the sacrifice, the extraordinary achievements that culminated in Allied victory. The other hat represents what might be called the stance of critical scrutiny, the imperative one feels to reconstruct the full story of what happened as accurately as possible, which means confronting those aspects of wartime that are controversial, ambiguous, or in some cases, just plain disgraceful. These two stances do not coexist comfortably together. They tend to elicit very different emotions from us as we seek to refine our comprehension of those tumultuous years. Nevertheless, if we want to avoid presenting a grievously distorted picture of World War II, we have to keep both these dimensions of the conflict clearly in mind. In our ongoing effort of understanding, we somehow have to do justice to both the triumphant crusade and the troubling elements of moral controversy that refuse to go away. Here, for example, are some of the war's most important gray areas, which we'll be exploring over the coming lectures. Bystanders. Did the United States, Britain, and France do all they could to help the Jews of Europe escape persecution in the years before the war? Civilian bombing. Was the deliberate targeting of large civilian populations justified? The shotgun wedding with Joseph Stalin. How did the United States and Britain deal with the fact that their ally, the USSR, was equally as vicious a tyranny as Nazi Germany? Resistance versus collaboration. Suppose you're a French man or woman living in German-occupied France. Should you continue to do your job, even though that job might be indirectly helping the Nazi war machine? Where does one draw the line? Kamikazes. Suicide attacks were often portrayed during the war as the hallmark of a degenerate Asian culture that placed little value on human life. If so, then how do we explain cases of extraordinary self-sacrifice in our own Western societies, such as those portrayed in the famous Tennyson poem, The Charge of the Light Brigade, or the suicidal attacks by American torpedo bombers at the Battle of Midway? The atomic bomb. Were we justified in dropping this extraordinarily powerful weapon? Racism. Even though there was no American Auschwitz, did the United States treat American citizens of Japanese descent fairly and equitably during the war? What about the treatment of black GIs fighting in the U.S. Army and Navy? Justice at Nuremberg. After the war, the Allies put the main Nazi leaders on trial for war crimes. But immediately the thorny questions arose. How far down the line of command should one go in judging the Nazis? Who should be considered directly responsible and who indirectly? These are some examples of the questions we'll be exploring. Why is this point about moral complexity important? Why am I making such a big deal about it? Because, by and large, the world is a complicated place. Most of the really important problems we face in our lives are not simple and straightforward. They're suffused with ambiguities and ambivalences of all sorts. In relationships with family or friends, we make painful choices and trade-offs. In our careers, we weigh the pros and cons of a certain pivotal course of action. In our daily lives, We juggle conflicting goals and priorities as we figure out how to devote our time and energies. The world does not come to us neatly arranged on a platter. We have to struggle endlessly to work things out for ourselves. Complexity rules our lives, whether we like it or not. So, if we want our thinking to be in touch with reality, not with some fantasy world of cartoon characters, we need to acquire the habit of mind that accepts complexity as a given. We need to accept that contrasts of pure black and pure white are the exception, not the rule. I think the highest tribute we can pay to the generation of the 1940s is to avoid over-idealizing them. Most of them did not see themselves as superheroes and would have been deeply uncomfortable to be portrayed as superheroes. They were ordinary men and women like you and me, with all our flaws and failings. It's precisely this that makes their achievements remarkable. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying here that heroic actions did not take place during World War II. They most certainly did. All kinds of them at all levels. We should remember those actions and honor those who carried them out. But that's precisely my point. What makes those heroic actions special is precisely the fact that they stood out from the ordinary day-to-day life of the war. If we want to get closer to understanding the war as it was, as reality rather than Hollywood movie, then we need to see both the heroism and the larger, infinitely more complicated context in which it occurred. We need to keep looking at the big picture in all its richness, contradictoriness, and yes, ordinariness. Only with this broader backdrop in place can we feel that we're reaching honestly for the wholeness of the past. Lecture 2, The Man Who Stopped Hitler's Atomic Bomb, Part 1. Today's lecture is not primarily about the moral gray areas of World War II. It's the story of the Norwegian secret agent who foiled Hitler's project to build a German atomic bomb. I'm starting the course off with it because it's emblematic of the war's most remarkable stories. Extremely high stakes, a few courageous men, a mind-boggling cliffhanger, the whole shape of world history hanging by the thinnest of threads. I'm piecing together this story from several sources: my own doctoral dissertation research, several documentary movies, and in particular, an excellent book by the historian Richard Rhodes titled The Making of the Atomic Bomb. I'll be reading you excerpts from Rhodes' prize-winning narrative, interspersed with first-person accounts from the people who were there, and with my own reconstruction of the story. If you're looking for a great read, I can't recommend Richard Rhodes' book highly enough, The Making of the Atomic Bomb. Most people today are unaware that it was not in the United States that the pioneering work toward harnessing atomic energy took place. It was in France, and then a bit later in Nazi Germany. Two generations of the Curie family in Paris had come a long way toward figuring out what this mysterious invisible force was that resided in certain kinds of rocks. They called it radioactivity. By the 1930s, German scientists had come far enough along to understand that radioactivity could be artificially induced in certain elements by manipulating them in their labs. In 1939, three German scientists, Otto Hahn, Lise Meitner, and Fritz Strassmann, made a giant leap forward. They identified the element uranium as the key substance that could be used to create nuclear fission. The news spread like wildfire through the elite international community of nuclear physicists. If fission was possible, then the release of atomic energy might not be far away. To a handful of prescient physicists, the implication was clear. It might be possible within the foreseeable future to create a colossal new type of bomb, based on the elemental energy that holds matter together. In the United States, this information led to the formation of a top-secret effort, the Manhattan Project, aimed at exploring the possibility of creating such an atomic bomb. I did part of my dissertation research on the man who first had the idea to do this, a Hungarian named Leo Szilard. We'll be returning to Szilard and the Manhattan Project in a later lecture. But there was one giant question hanging over the small circle of people working feverishly on the bomb project in the U.S. Statesmen, military officers, and scientists all asked themselves the same question. Was Hitler building a bomb too? If he was, how far along was he? It was like running a race against an adversary whom you can't see, so you can't know if he's ahead of you or behind you. And the stakes of the race are that if you lose, you'll be killed or enslaved. Nazi Germany was indeed working on building an atomic bomb. But Hitler remained skeptical that the project would succeed in time to make a difference in the war. It seemed too complicated, too abstract and theoretical. It smacked of what he called Jewish science. This is the derogatory term Hitler used to describe theoretical physics in the Einstein era. So Hitler assigned this technological possibility only a medium-level priority, compared, for instance, to his projects in the domain of jet aircraft and rocketry. Nevertheless, he did order a sizable German scientific team to be assembled and to begin the complex task of building a German atomic bomb. Now, the main thing you need for an atomic bomb is the right amount of fissionable material. There were several ways to manufacture this material, and in the United States, they were all tried simultaneously in secret installations at the University of Chicago, Hanford, Washington, and Oak Ridge, Tennessee. The Germans decided to put all their bets on one particular method based on something called heavy water. Heavy water was a modified form of water that could be used as a neutron moderator in the complex industrial process of enriching uranium for use as an explosive. The German team realized that they would need a lot of heavy water to make their project work. So they were naturally delighted when, early in the war, in April 1940, the German army was able to overrun the country of Norway very easily and rapidly. Because tucked away in a remote place called Vemork, in the jagged mountainous terrain of southern Norway, was one of Europe's largest and most modern factories of heavy water. Norsk Hydro was its name. Immediately, the Nazi scientist started the factory working round the clock producing heavy water. It was a frustratingly slow process. Drop by drop, in a succession of 18 huge vats, the heavy water was refined and concentrated by electrolysis, each vat leading to a more concentrated solution of the precious liquid, then passing it on to the next vat for further concentration. By the time you got to vat number 18, the solution was about 97% pure. With the capture of this factory, Norsk Hydro, the timetable for building a German bomb jumped forward by about one full year. Keep in mind that no one knew at this time how long the war was going to last. The U.S. was still out of the fray. The Manhattan Project was still a relatively small and exploratory undertaking. If the Germans had been able to keep at their work uninterrupted, we can estimate in hindsight that their bomb might have been ready in as little as 6 years. Clearly, this possibility was a nightmare to the small circle of scientists, military officers, and statesmen in Britain and America who were in on the secret. It became, in effect, one of the most closely guarded secrets of the war. Hitler and the Allies were in a race to build what was, without a doubt, a war-winning weapon. So the Brits decided that the Norsk Hydro factory at Vemork in Norway would have to be destroyed. Absolutely top priority. They planned carefully, establishing a broad network of contacts with courageous Norwegian men and women who had joined the anti-Nazi resistance, hiding among the fjords and remote valleys of their native country. On November 19, 1942, the Brits sent in two highly trained demolition teams, flying in gliders, towed across the North Sea from Scotland. Both planes crashed, and the survivors were quickly caught by the Germans and executed the same day. The Brits knew they could not afford to stop trying. In February 1943, on a freezing cold night, six Norwegian commandos were parachuted into the snowdrifts of the countryside near Vemork. Here I'm going to read to you from Richard Rhodes's Pulitzer Prize-winning reconstruction of events. The men wore white jumpsuits over British Army uniforms and parachuted with skis, supplies, a shortwave radio, and 18 sets of plastic explosives, one for each of the 18 stainless steel electrolysis cells of the high-concentration plant. They set out mid-evening on Saturday, February 27, 1943, leaving one man behind to guard the radios. They carried cyanide capsules and agreed that if anyone was wounded, he would take his own life rather than allow himself to be captured and risk betraying his comrades. They crashed down through soft snow all the way to the bottom of the gorge, crossed the frozen river, climbed up toward the plant on the other side. Above, at the elevation of the shelf, was a seldom-used railroad siding leading into the compound that they hoped the Germans had chosen not to mine. One of the commando leaders, Knut Haukelid, later described in his memoirs what it was like. It was a dark night and there was no moon. The searchlights were kept turned off, and the high wind drowned all the noise we made. Half an hour before midnight, we came to a snow-covered building 500 yards from Vemork, where we ate a little chocolate and waited for the change of sentries. We divided into two groups, a demolition party and a covering party. We were well armed, five Tommy guns among nine men, and everyone had a pistol, a knife, and hand grenades. In an hour, time for the sentries to settle, they attacked. Haukelid in the covering party led the way. With bolt cutters, they snipped the thin little iron chain which barred the way to one of the most important military objectives in Europe. The covering party dispersed to its prearranged positions. Haukelid and one other man took up posts 20 yards from the German army barracks, a flimsy wooden building that they saw they could easily shoot through. And the demolition party moved ahead. The doors on the ground floor of the plant were locked, but the Norwegian resistance had identified for the commandos a cable intake that they could crawl along that led directly to the heavy water facility. Two men looked for some other entrance, while two disappeared into the cable intake. After what seemed to Haukelid an interminable delay, he heard an explosion, but an astonishingly small, insignificant one. He asked himself, was this what we had come over 1,000 miles to do? The guards were slow to check. Only one German soldier appeared and seemed not to realize what had happened. He tried the doors to the plant, found them locked, looked to see if snow falling from the mountain above had detonated a landmine, and returned to his quarters. The Norwegians moved out fast. They had descended to the river before the sirens began to sound. The operation was successful. No one was injured on either side. All 18 cells had been blown open, spilling nearly half a ton of heavy water into the drains. Not only would the plant require weeks to repair, but because it was a cascade, pumping water of increasing heavy water concentration from one cell to the next, it would need almost a year of operation after repair simply to reach equilibrium again on its own and begin producing. General Nikolaus von Falkenhorst, the commander-in-chief of the occupying German army in Norway, called the Vemork attack, quote, "the best coup I have ever seen." So now we're leaving Richard Rhodes's narrative and coming back to me. Nevertheless, by the fall of 1943, 6 months after the raid, Norwegian intelligence operatives began reporting back to London that the Germans had succeeded in getting the Norsk hydro plant back into operation much more quickly than anticipated. How? By shipping up from Germany all the nation's laboratory stock of the precious heavy water so that the 18 vats in the factory could restart production immediately. The Brits decided that once again, something had to be done, urgently. The idea of a second commando raid was quashed right away because the Germans had massively beefed up security around the Vemork factory and the nearby town of Ryukan. So the only alternative appeared to be aerial bombing. On November 16, 1943, several hundred B-17 bombers from the American 8th Air Force were dispatched to Norway from British bases. 140 made it through German air defenses and bombed Vemork heavily, destroying the factory's power station and damaging its main electrolysis unit. At this point, the Germans decided the best thing to do was simply to dismantle the factory and ship it, along with all the heavy water in its vats, back down to Germany. The plan was to reassemble the factory in a mineshaft under a German mountain, safe from bombers and saboteurs. But the heavy water itself was far more precious than the factory, for a new factory could be fairly rapidly pieced together, but the water was irreplaceable. It embodied 2 years of laboriously accumulated stocks, and time was of the essence if an atomic weapon was going to make any difference in Germany's war. As a side note, it's worth noting that, unbeknownst to the Germans, there was a whole railroad tank car full of French heavy water sitting on a siding in a rail yard in Paris. It sat there through the entire war, and the Germans never found out about it. In February 1944, spies belonging to the Norwegian underground alerted London by radio. The German military would be shipping the precious heavy water from Norway back down to Germany in less than 2 weeks' time. The Brits and Americans cast desperately about for a solution. There simply wasn't enough time to train and send in a new group of commandos. Only one man from the previous commando attack of 1943 was still in place near the town of Ryukan, watching over the Norsk Hydro factory. It was Knut Haukelid, who had been living there in hiding, dodging the Germans continually, for just over a year. The British and American officers in London came to a grim conclusion. Knut Haukelid would somehow have to do the job by himself. He would have to destroy the heavy water at some point as it was being shipped from the factory to the Norwegian coast. The officers in London radioed him his orders. Haukelid quickly began recruiting helpers from the Norwegian underground near Ryukan. He studied the path that the train carrying the heavy water shipment would be taking. It looked as though the weakest link in the journey would be the moment when the train cars were loaded onto a ferry boat and carried across the local lake, a long, deep body of water named Lake Tinsio. He rode the ferry boat back and forth several times, carefully timing its trips so that he knew exactly when it would be crossing the deepest part of the lake, some 1,300 feet deep. The ferryboat's name, ironically, was the Hydro, just like the factory whose top secret products it would be carrying. Haukelid prepared a large supply of plastic explosive and calculated how large a hole he would have to blow in the forward part of the ferry's hull if it was to sink before it could be beached or steered to shallower waters. He borrowed two alarm clocks and modified them so that their hammers struck not bells but contact plates, closing a battery-powered electrical circuit that could fire the detonators. On February 10, 1944, he reported back to London with his plan. Here's what London said in reply. Agree to sinking of ferry with cargo in deep water, preferably between Hesleviken and Digerud. If the sea cocks are opened, this must be combined with an explosion to indicate a limpet mine attack from outside. The engine must be put out of order so that the ferry cannot be driven further to shallow water. The sinking must not fail, as the method of attack will thereby be disclosed. Leave British uniform effects, if possible, at suitable place. Good luck. The part about the British uniforms was important, because otherwise the Germans would think this was an attack by members of the Norwegian resistance and would take a fearsome revenge on the civilians in nearby villages and towns, as they regularly did all over Europe to deter such attacks. Finally, on the night of February 20th, 1944, well past midnight, Knut Haukelid and two trusted helpers from the underground drove down to the wharf where the ferry was docked. The train cars carrying the heavy water had not yet been loaded onto the boat. He could see them parked on a railroad siding several hundred meters away, lit up with floodlights and surrounded by sentries. Here is Haukelid narrating in his memoir. Armed with Sten guns, pistols, and hand grenades, we crept down toward the ferry. The bitterly cold night set everything creaking and crackling. The ice on the road snapped sharply as we went over it. When we came out on the bridge by the ferry station, there was as much noise as if a whole company was on the march. Rolf and the other Ryukan man were told to cover me while I went on board the ferry to reconnoiter. All was quiet there. Was it possible that the Germans had omitted to place a guard at the weakest point in the whole route to the transport? Hearing voices in the crew's quarters, forward, I stole to the companionway and listened. There must be a party going on down there and a game of poker. The other two followed me onto the deck of the ferry. We went down to the third-class accommodation and found a hatchway leading to the bilges. But before we had got the hatch open, we heard steps and took cover behind the nearest table or chair. The ferry watchman was standing in the doorway. Lecture 3, The Man Who Stopped Hitler's Atomic Bomb, Part 2. I looked up at the ferry watchman and thought fast, realizing that the situation was awkward but not necessarily dangerous. I told the watchman we were escaping the Gestapo and needed a place to hide. The watchman immediately showed us the hatchway in the deck and told us that they had several times carried illegal things with them on their trips. The Ryukan man now proved invaluable. He talked and talked with the watchman, while Rolf and I flung our sacks down under the deck and began to work. It was an anxious job, and it took time. Haukelid and Rolf Sorli found themselves standing on the bottom plates of the boat in a foot of cold water. They had to tape the two alarm clock timers to one of the steel stringers that braced the ferry's hull, attach four electric detonators to the timers, attach high-speed fuses to the loop of plastic explosive, lay the charge of explosive on the bottom plates, and then, most dangerously, hook up batteries to detonators and detonators to fuses. Here's Haukelid's memoir. The charge was placed in the water and concealed. It consisted of 19 pounds of high explosive laid in the form of a sausage. We laid it in the forward part of the bilge so that the rudder and propeller would rise above the surface when water began to come in, and in this way would prevent navigating the boat to shallower water. When the charge exploded, it would blow about 11 square feet out of the ship's side. Rolf Sorley went up on deck. Haukelid set his alarms to go off at 10:45 a.m. Quote, "Making the last connection was a dangerous job. For an alarm clock is an uncertain instrument, and a contact between the hammer and the alarm was avoided by not more than a third of an inch. Thus, there was one third of an inch between us and disaster." But everything worked, and he finished at 4 a.m. The Ryukan man had convinced the watchman by then that the escapees he had sheltered needed to return to Ryukan to collect their possessions. Haukelid considered warning their benefactor, but decided that this might endanger the mission, and only thanked him and shook his hand. 10 minutes from the ferry station, Haukelid and Larsen put on skis and began the long trek to Kongsberg, 40 miles away around the lake, where they would catch a train for the first leg of their escape to Sweden. Sorley carried a report for London to the clandestine radio. 6 hours later, with 53 people aboard, as well as the railroad cars of heavy water, the ferry sailed on time. 45 minutes into the crossing, Haukelid's charge of plastic explosive blew the hull. The captain felt the explosion rather than heard it, and though Tinsjö is landlocked, he thought they might have been torpedoed. The bow swamped first, as Haukelid had intended. While the passengers and crew struggled to release the lifeboats, the freight cars, with their 39 drums of heavy water, broke loose, rolled overboard, and sank like stones. Of passengers and crew, 26 drowned. Later, in an interview after the war, Kurt Diebner of German Army Ordnance described the full effect of the sinking of the Hydro. Quote, "When one considers that right up to the end of the war in 1945, there was virtually no increase in our heavy water stocks in Germany, it will be seen that it was the elimination of German heavy water production in Norway that was the main factor in our failure to achieve a self-sustaining atomic reactor before the war ended." And so Richard Rhodes concludes, "The race to the bomb, such as it was, ended for Germany on a mountain lake in Norway on a cold Sunday morning in February 1944. So, why have I told you this story? Well, because it captures some of the main elements of why World War II still fascinates us today. A deadly peril. Would Adolf Hitler get nukes or not? Brave men taking awesome risks. A game with extremely far-reaching consequences, resting on the tiniest of details, like the personality of a night watchman, or the one-third of an inch between the alarm clock hammer and the bell. One man, Knut Haukelid, making a deep mark on the course of world history, and then fading away after the war into the obscurity of civilian life. How many of you listening to this lecture had heard about Knut Haukelid before today? One of my favorite parts of this story is this. Knut Haukelid, on the night of the ferry boat attack, has to steal a car to get from his hiding place to the wharf where the ferry is anchored. But the car he steals has been converted by its owner to run on methane instead of gasoline. This was common during the war when gasoline was scarce. And he and his two companions have a hell of a time getting the car started. German soldiers walking by, snickering at them. It goes on for just under 1 hour. Picture it. The starter's noise on the car, turning, rear, 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 rear. Over and over again, waiting, rear, 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 rear. Slowing down because the battery's running down, rear, 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 rear. Waiting, thinking, we're running out of time. If we don't get to the ferry soon, it'll be too late to get in there and plant the explosives. Try again. Rear, 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 rear. It's the only car available. From the back seat, your companion says, you flooded it. And you're thinking, if I can't get this car to start, Hitler is going to get the atomic bomb. Rear, 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 rear. You try again. German soldiers passing by with their machine guns, amused at these clueless, unmechanical Norwegians who can't even get a car started in the middle of the night. Haukelid trying to keep a bland smile on his face. And finally, vroom, and off they go into history. When I speak of high stakes, it's worth pausing for a moment to think about what was at stake in World War II. It's not an exaggeration to say world domination. And here it's useful to make a comparison of what the stakes were in the First World War as compared with the Second. In World War I, whoever wins, whoever loses, what's at stake is basically the acquisition of new territory and of new imperial holdings. So Germany loses. But there's never any serious question of whether Germany itself will continue to exist after the surrender. Nobody is seriously suggesting that all the people of Germany, men, women, and children, should all be killed. In World War II, what's at stake is a fundamental reshaping of world power, in which some peoples will gain, some peoples will lose, and some peoples will simply disappear off the face of the earth. It's about extermination, survival at the most elemental level. Can we imagine what the world would be like today if Hitler had won? In a sense, it's an impossible question to answer, but it's thought-provoking nonetheless. How different would things be? Supposing you were alive in this alternative world, how different would your life be? How different would you be? The scale of World War II is also a factor. It is, quite simply, the biggest.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.